very much appreciate it, and I'm very grateful to be here. I'd like to thank the organizers for giving me the opportunity to be a second time in Japan for the Biohackathon. And also to have the chance to talk about the work that the Monarch Initiative has been doing over the course of the last years. Now, when the title was set, I wasn't really sure exactly what I'm going to talk about. So the clinical is slightly in brackets because you'll see that I'm kind of crossing from basic to translational and back with respect to the work that's being done. So, we started from the idea that the genome is sequenced, but if you are to if you are to really look at the genotype phenotype association, we really don't know that much about it, and especially about the pathogenicity and the expression, the phenotypic expression of some of the some of the variants that are there and that are being reported both in the literature as well as in the existing variant repositories. And if you are to look at the standard clinical, so and here I guess the clinical part is quite important, so the standard clinical pipelines, you can see that really they're able only to leverage only a fraction of the data. So you have a standard clinical pipeline goes through eliminating I guess the low quality variants and then looking into existing population frequency databases such as for example the one that has been discussed in the previous presentation. And then you end up with about 100 variants, and then the clinician usually what it does, it goes through this, that 100 variants manually to really understand the correlation between or the association between that variant and the phenotype. So this part under us, I guess, the yellow part on this slide, when it comes to really the clinical phenotypes that the patient expresses and that are being observed by the clinician, as well as their presence, for example, in existing omic databases outside, it's not used at its full potential, especially from a semi-automated or automated manner rather than just by manual introspection. Obviously, with the goal of having a diagnosis or, if possible, a treatment. So, if you are to really look at this. The coverage of the phenotypic coverage by genes, if you are to look at really the human side of things, you can see here that about 9,000 genes are covered, and then if you look at the model organism data, you see that the coverage is much larger, and in reality, if you are to put them together, you end up with an almost, about 90% coverage of the genes in phenotypic expression of the genes. So I guess really this really screams out for closing that gap between what is really being correctly done in clinical practice and the immense amount of work that has been done especially in the model organism area with respect to describing the phenotypes and capturing these genotype phenotype associations. Now there's various challenges that we're trying to deal with, and the Monarch Initiative has worked on over the last five years or so. One of them in particular is the fact that there are obviously different communities use different languages, and this is by no means, a new topic. If you have a patient, obviously patients are not particularly good expressing their phenotypes by means of medical terms. So the medical terminology is not something that perhaps they're used to, while doctors they have their own medical nomenclature which they're using, and then when you cross the bridge onto the model organism space, obviously you have a completely different terminology, completely different ways of expressing the same thing. So yeah, you end up basically with this triangle where you have a patient that's trying to express what they're feeling and what their symptomatology, you have your doctor that has their own terminology, and then you have the model organism that have a completely different way of expressing things, and the question is how do you put these things together. Now the same sort of challenge is then immediately transported also at the data level or the knowledge level or the way in which the knowledge is represented and structured currently. If you look at very similarly, if you look at basically all the existing model organism knowledge bases or ontologies, you see that they're all kind of working well using their own vocabularies. And or their own ontology. So the question here, and that's on the model organism side of things. And to some extent, you can say, is justified, right? Because you're describing a particular model organism, particular, you know, an exact particular domain, if you may. And it makes sense to some extent to have its own ontology. But then if you look at the clinical space, and if we include HPO as part of the clinical space, you know, in the clinical space itself, you have the same sort of problem. And in reality, you know, technically speaking, they're kind of expressing the same thing, because the domain is the same, right? So you have things along the lines of SNOMED, you have HPO, you have your NCI, your NCI results, and so on and so forth, which overlap to a large extent when it comes to the clinical. Okay. So the aim is really to come up with or work towards some sort of representation that allows obviously computer understandable, the processable representation of the phenotypes that allows us to bridge those gaps as well as to really make a difference to the patients. Because at the end of the day, that's I guess what's the most important aspect. And the way in which some of the people actually in this room, you know, like Rob over there in the back, have worked on achieving this is by decomposing complex concepts and really allowing for interoperability. So going from one particular concept in the human phenotype ontology, as you see there, decomposing it by means of other ontologies which are actually foundational and express foundational concepts such as, for example, Pareto. Or the probability of the processing go bridging ontologies for capturing anatomical structures and to end up with basically a similar concept in a different phenotype ontology or in a different representation for the same concept where. And you can see that this basically enables immediately so the closing that bridge between you know what's a human phenotype and also a model organism phenotype or even a phenotype expressed by means of lay language. So this is a very brief overview of what the Monarch has achieved. Where you can see basically the bridging ontology that have been either created or maintained by the Monarch ontologies and the various data sources, and you can see that the domains that they cover, like the genes, variants, phenotypes, and so on and so forth, and how they managed to integrate these data sources and the annotations associated with them by means of these bridging ontologies. Now, going back again to the clinical world. What does really this mean from a clinical perspective or from a patient perspective? Well, if we take a step back and we talk about the human phenotype ontology, which I'm sure that at least a third of you at least have heard about. So human phenotype ontology is really an ontology that captures phenotypic terms or abnormalities in the human space, and it is associated with about 125,000 annotations to various diseases, either captured or expressed by using OMIM or Orphanet. And we've done an exercise also a couple of years ago. So given the history behind HPO, which has emerged from the rare disorder space, obviously it is geared towards rare disorders. But we've done an exercise a couple of years ago to understand really what's really its applicability and also in the common disease space. And it turns out that it's actually was fairly good. Obviously, there's still work to be done with respect to covering some of the gaps, especially for example, in the mental disorders area, which is particularly complex. But for things like cardiovascular disorders or for renal disorders was fairly good. So going from the work on bridging ontologies and using HPO as a clinical nomenclature, as a clinical terminology, what you can do immediately as a clinician is really bridge that gap between a patient that you see in front of you that has a certain phenotype profile to if the variant is, you know, or you don't really get anything out of the initial analysis to a model organism and immediately to be able to see if you find a variant that is the model organism that is also present in your patient. And this is okay. Let me go to the next one. So basically, this is exactly how, for example, it has made a difference a couple of years ago to a real patient in the undiagnosed disease program, where this methodology has been used to find and solve a case. Now, this particular case, going back one slide, has been realized using the Exomizer package, or the Exomizer software that is being developed by the Moran Initiative, that combines what we would call a standard variant analysis with a phenotype score across model organisms to come towards a combined score for prioritizing the variants. In the meantime, it's also a genomizer version that works across some of the non-coding areas. So, if I am to take a step back, to show you some of the other sort of tools that the Monarch has developed in the same sort of space of semantic similarity and using sort of phenotype profile comparison. You can see here a phenobarbital, for example, where this is on the Monarch initiative page. You can choose a bunch of phenotypes, you can create a great phenotype profile, and you immediately get an overview of the disorders that are in the human space, ranked by the similarity, but also the genes that are associated with that sort of phenotype profile in the various model organism space. You can see here mouse and so on. So one last item I would like to know. I do have a couple of other things, so I could talk about this for a couple of hours. but I'm going to stop to this aspect, which is really more about the, I guess, interoperability and the work that we've been doing in the with respect to the phenotype exchange format, which is a format that we're really hoping that is really trying to enable appropriate or a proper data integration across a couple of very well-known silos or very well-known phenotype silos, such as, for example, papers and journals and clinical trials or patient registries, each of them capturing phenotypes in either in their own way or in their own nomenclature, or even if when they're capturing them using HPO, the way in which the information would flow from one silo to another is not particularly well defined. So here's a very brief example of how to model age of onset, and so there are some other examples you can find on the phenopackets.org website. So how you model age of onset in a phenotype profile, having a phenotype and associating the appropriate age of onset to the phenotype, and obviously also including the evidence for that particular statement. And we're trying to eat our own dog food, if you may, and creating tools that enable people to create this phenotype phenopackets. And this is such a tool where you either upload a publication or you enter a piece of text, just very briefly copy paste a piece of text. And this allows you to basically very quickly get to a bunch of HPO terms which are highlighted there, and manually, so using it as a curation platform, manually very very quickly create basically a phenopacket for a particular patient and pushing this into our phenopackets.org repository. Now this is work in progress, so do not expect that you're actually going to get everything there, but it's working. And this here is, for the time being, a GitHub repo. Now, I think the last thing I'm going to touch on, although I do have a couple of other slides there, is that Melissa and Peter and Chris, they were really trying to push this idea of standardizing phenotype descriptions and using phenopackets across the board. And obviously, one of the first targets were the publishers, because I guess when it comes to discovery, most discoveries are, and because of the way in which the current academic system works, are present in the publication, but also kind of trapped there. And once you have them there, you're not really able to very quickly get them out. This is an example of where they were able to at least make a first step towards having actual HPO codes embedded or part of the publication, in the molecular case studies of Cosmic Hardware. Although it's not even far from being perfect, right? Because it's still, you know, it's still text, but it's still it's a first step. In the meantime, it's worth mentioning that we would have similar attempts, and we've worked with the Orphanet Red Zorler Journal to do something similar. Unfortunately, still at the step of having the actual text, you know, the HPO IDs and the actual text being included in the publication, rather than something that is already represented as structured data and easily reproducible or extractable for computation purposes. So I'm going to stop here. I would like to thank everyone that is being involved. There's a large number of people involved in this, and this is really just, I guess, just scraping the surface with respect to the work that the Monarch Initiative does. But at least I'm hoping that I've raised some awareness, and I would like to thank you so much.